فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. My beloved brothers and sisters, as you are all aware of, the great noble month, شهر رمضان, is coming our way. It's a month in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about it, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. It is the month that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala had sent down the Quran. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He gave this particular month over all of the other months in the year. He gave it khasa'is. He gave it distinct, unique virtue. And from the things which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala He gave it is khulufu fami sa'im, the odor and the smell that comes from the mouth of the person who is fasting. Atyabu 'indallahi min rihil misk. It smells more to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it smells better to Him, min rihil misk, than the smell of misk. Also, the angels, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. لِلصَّائِمِينَ, the ones who are fasting. حَتَّى يُفْطِرُوا, until they break their fasting. The third virtue, and the third unique virtue that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given this month of Ramadan is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He beautifies every single day Jannah for the people who are fasting. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, يُوشِكُ عِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحُونَ, my slaves who are righteous, they are very close to entering into this place. The fourth virtue, the fourth unique virtue that this month has is the shayateen are chained. The fifth unique characteristics which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this month is tuftahu fi abwab al-jannah wa tughlaqu abwab al-nar. The doors of Jannah are open and the doors of the hellfire are closed. The sixth unique characteristics that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to give this particular month, شهر رمضان, is فيه ليلة القدر هي خير من ألف شهر من حرم خيرها فقد حرم خير الكثير. In it is ليلة القدر. Laylatul Qadr is better than 1,000 months. من حرم, anybody who's prevented the virtue of this particular month or this particular night, Laylatul Qadr, فقد حرم الخير كله. All forms of good are prohibited from you. If you do not achieve good on Laylatul Qadr, then you truly have lost every good there is. The seventh unique virtue that this month has been given is يُغْفَرُ لِلصَّائِمِينَ فِي آخِرِ لَيْلَةٍ مِّن رَمَضَانِ. Every night, the people who are fasting, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He forgives them. And the last but not least unique virtue for this month of Ramadan is لله عتقاء من النار وذلك كل ليلة من رمضان. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He has people, He has slaves, He frees from the hellfire, and that is only in every single night of Ramadan. So I say to my beloved brothers and sisters, is there any month that you know that has gathered all of those virtues? It is a month. Its virtue, its unique virtue, has not been compiled in any other month the way it has been in Ramadan. So each and every one of us has to face Ramadan and to benefit from Ramadan bitawbatin nasuh. We need to come with sincere repentance wal'azimati sadiqah, and that we come with unwavering conviction on what? Ala ightinamihi, that we're going to benefit from Ramadan. We need to come with an unwavering conviction. We need to come with a determination that when Ramadan enters, we truly are going to benefit from it. We also need to fill our time bil a'mal as-saliha, righteous actions. And we also have to ask Allah sincerely al-i'anata ala husn ibadatihi. We have to ask Allah that He aids us and He supports us in coming with these righteous actions. Ikhwati al-fudala, my beloved brothers and sisters, I wanted to, inshallah ta'ala, state some righteous actions that become very important in Ramadan, that become very important for each and every one of us to come with. The first of those is as-sawm, fasting. This month we have to fast, but many of us don't truly understand what fasting means. Our perception and our understanding of fasting is very shallow. The reality of fasting, my beloved brothers and sisters, is to not fast only from food and drinking, but is to fast also from your shahawat, your desires. ولذلك the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says من لم يدع قول الزور, the prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام says explicitly, من لم يدع قول الزور والعمل به فليس لله حاجة في أن يدع طعامه وشرابه. أخرجه البخاري. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us that the person who doesn't leave off false testimony, he lies, deceives, causes corruption in the earth, and he also acts in ignorance, foul language, doesn't protect his tongue, doesn't safeguard his private part, فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ, Allah doesn't have any need from you. Allah doesn't require from you, سبحانه وتعالى في أن يدع طعامه وشرابه, that you leave off drinking and eating. That doesn't mean that the fasting is uplifted from you, but what it means is that you have truly destroyed the true concept. You have truly gone against the true essence of what fasting is. This is a month where you fast from two things. You fast from your shahawat, your desires. And you also fast from eating and drinking. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, as-sawm junnah, fasting is a shield. فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ صَوْمُ أَحَدِكُمْ, that if one of you is fasting, فَلَا يَرْفَثْ وَلَا يَفْسُقْ, don't be foul language, don't speak foul, don't have sexual intercourse. فَإِنْ سَابَّهُ أَحَدٌ, if anyone insults you, uses foul language against you, ridicules you, فَلْيَقُلْ, say to them, إِنِّي مُرُؤٌ صَائِمٌ, I am a fasting person. أخرجه البخاري ومسلم. So if you are fasting, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, O slave of Allah, you are fasting, then let your mouth fast. Let your hearings, your ears fast with you. Let your eyesight also fast with you. Let your tongue also fast with you. Let all of your limbs fast with you. And do not let your fasting only be fasting from food and drinking. If you come with that, then you have truly come with what fasting is, what sawm is. The second righteous action that one can come with in Ramadan is al-qiyam, that the person stands this night. Standing here, my beloved brothers and sisters, it means standing in prayer. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. Anyone who stands in the month of Ramadan with two characteristics, إيمانا واحتسابا, you stand up with sincerity and hoping reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then and only then your sins will be forgiven for you. And inshallah ta'ala, what it means, iman and wahtisaba, I will leave that to the end of my lecture. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-Furqan, ayah 63 to ayah 64, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. Allah says, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ, the true slaves of Allah, are who? الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا, they walk on this earth. They walk on this earth in a state of tranquility, humility and humbleness. وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا, when the ignorant ones address them ignorantly and they speak to them in an ignorant manner, قَالُوا سَلَامًا, they respond by saying, peace be upon you. وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا, and they are ones who spend their night to their Lord in a state of prostration, in a state of prayer, remembering their Lord. So this is the characteristics of Ibadur Rahman, the true slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters, Qiyamul Layl, standing at night, is Da'bu Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was the characteristics that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was known to do. Not only him, but also his companions. Aisha, the wife of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the wife of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana la yada'u qiyam al-layli, he never used to leave off praying at night. Wa kana idha marida aw kasal salla qa'ida, he was alayhi salatu wa salam one who, if he became sick or he became unable to pray that night, he would pray sitting down. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never used to leave it. Now some of you may say that because it was obligatory on him, and I respond by saying yes, it was obligatory on him, and na'am, he had to come with it. But here, my beloved brothers and sisters, is also the example of the companions. It wasn't obligatory on them, and they also used to pray. Even that though, we say that our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a role model for us. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ, there is a great example in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for us. But here I'm going to bring to your attentions the noble companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, how they used to pray in this great noble month of Ramadan, and also outside this great noble month of Ramadan. كَانَ عُمَرُ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ, Umar, the son of Khattab, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, his forgiveness and continuous blessing be upon him, and may Allah be pleased with Umar. He was one. يصلي من الليل, he would pray from the night, ما شاء الله, that which Allah willed. حتى إذا كان نصف الليل, when it would become half of the night, أيقظ أهله, he would wake his wife up to pray with him. And he would say, and would recite the verse of Allah, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقًا نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. وَأْمُرْ command أَهْلَكَ your family بِالصَّلَاةِ by praying, وَاصْطَبِرْ and be patient upon that. لَا نَسْأَلُكَ we do not request and ask of you رِزْقًا provision, نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ we are the ones who are going to provide for you. وَالْعَاقِبَةُ and the final ending is for لِلْتَقْوَى piety and those who come with it. Ibn Umar, he used to recite this verse instead. He would say, أَمَّنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ أَمَّنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ سَاجِدًا وَقَائِمًا يَحْذَرُ الْآخِرَةَ وَيَرْجُو رَحْمَةَ رَبِّهِ. Are they equal? The one who stands in the night, in prostration, in standing, who's scared of the hereafter, who is also hoping from the mercy of Allah, is he the same as the one who does it? Here also is the noble companion Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Ibn Abi Hatim, whose name is Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Hatim. He said that Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said about Uthman, لِكَثْرَةِ صَلَاةِ أَبِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, Uthman's excessive prayer of the night and his recitation, it was so excessive and it was so large and so much, حَتَّى أَنَّهُ رُبَّمَا قَرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي رَكْعَةٍ, he may even read the whole Quran in one rak'ah. نعم. Uthman رضي الله عنه, it was said about him that his salah at the night would be so excessive and it would be so much that he would recite and he would pray in the salah and he would finish the whole salah, the whole Quran in one rak'ah. Now some of us may ask themselves this question, how is that possible? How is that possible and how would he do it? I remember asking this question to our noble Shaykh, Shaykh Saleh ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi. I asked him the same question. I said, how is it possible? And he said to me a very powerful and a very strong response. He said to me, you are comparing the companions to yourself. When you became unable to do it, and you became unable to accomplish that which they accomplished, you thought they were like you. These are people who Allah has said about them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. They are pleased with Allah and Allah is pleased with them. Also, my beloved brothers and sisters, Alqamah ibn Qays, he said, bittu ma'a Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Mas'udin. Alqamah ibn Qays said, I spent the night and I slept over in the house of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud one night. فَقَامَ أَوَّلَ اللَّيْلِ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنِ مَسْعُودِ, he stood up the first of the night and he stood up and he prayed. فَكَانَ يَقْرَأُ قِرَاءَةَ الْإِمَامِ فِي مَسْجِدِ حَيِّهِ, he started to read the recitation of the Imam. Here meaning قِرَاءَةُ الْإِمَامِ means the قِرَاءَةُ of the Mus'haf of Uthman, and after the Uthman compiled the Quran and he would recite it. وَلَا يُرَاجِعُ يَسْمَعُ مَنْ حَوْلَهُ وَلَا يَرْجِعُ صَوْتَهُ حتى لم يبقى من الغلس إلا كما بين أذان المغرب إلى انصراف منها ثم أوتره. That he used to recite the recitation of the Imam in his local masjid he would lead, and he would recite Uthman رضي الله عنه ولا يراجع, and he wouldn't revise. Those who were around him would hear him. His voice would not come back until the ghalas, the fajr entering, was close as, or the duration for the salatul fajr to enter was like the adhan of maghrib and the leaving of the prayer of the maghrib. That duration is how much would be left from fajr. As-Sa'ib ibn Zayd, he said, كان القارئ, that a reciter would read, بِالْمِئِينَ, مِئِين here means بِمِئَاتِ الْآيَاتِ, he would read with hundreds of verses. They would lead the prayer with hundreds of verses, حَتَّى كُنَّا نَعْتَمِدُ عَلَى الْعَصَى, that we would actually lean and we would actually hold our sticks, مِنْ طُولِ الْقِيَامِ, due to the excessive and the length of the standing, our legs would get tired. وَمَا كَانُوا يَنْصَرِفُونَ إِلَّا عِنْدَ الْفَجْرِ, and they would not stop the prayer until Fajr will enter, until Fajr is about to enter. So my beloved brothers and sisters, what I want to bring to your attention is Salatul Taraweeh is going to be prayed in this noble month, that we should complete the Taraweeh with the Imam, so it can be written for us that we stood up the whole night. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ قَامَ مَعَ إِمَامِهِ, anyone who stands with his Imam, حَتَّى يَنْصَرِفَ كُتِبَ لَهُ قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ أَمَا كُتِبَ قِيَامُ لَيْلَهِ, anyone who stands up with the Imam until the Imam leaves the prayer, it will be written for him as though he stood up the night. It's as though you were prayed all of the night. رَوَاهُ أَهْلُ السُّنَنِ. So my beloved brothers and sisters, the thing that you could come with is standing, and making sure that you come with Al-Qiyam. The third righteous action that we can come with in this noble month of Ramadan is As-Sadaqah, that we make sure that we work hard on charity and giving. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was said about him, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس. The Messenger was the most generous person. وكان أجود ما يكون في رمضان. And his generosity would be even more in the noble month of Ramadan. He was more generous عليه الصلاة والسلام. He was more generous عليه الصلاة والسلام من الريح المرسلة than the sent wind عليه الصلاة والسلام. And it was also authentically transmitted from him, as Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated on the authority of Anas ibn Malik and radiallahu ta'ala anhu, أفضل الصدقة صدقة في رمضان, that the best form of charity is the charity that is given in the noble month of Ramadan. So the believer in this month of Ramadan, he makes sure that his generosity and his giving, it increases and it multiplies. If it was said about our Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام that he was more generous in the noble month of Ramadan, then we should also follow in his footsteps. And if it was also transmitted from him عليه الصلاة والسلام that the best form of sadaqah is the sadaqah of Ramadan, then we should also make sure that we give more in this month than in any other time in the year. Zayd ibn Aslam, he narrated from his father that he heard Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu say, that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن نتصدق. Umar said that the Prophet commanded us that we give charity. So Umar radiallahu anhu, today he's in front of the Messenger, and the Messenger is telling him and commanding him and all the other companions to give today, sadaqah. So Umar radiallahu anhu saw an opportunity to compete with the noble companion Abu Bakr. So what Umar radiallahu anhu he did, he said to himself, Al-Yawma, today, I am going to surpass Abu Bakr. I am going to pass Abu Bakr, and I'm going to make sure that I come with what is greater than what Abu Bakr has come with. And this, my beloved brothers and sisters, is nothing except the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ, compete with one another in good. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه, he brought his sadaqah. And Umar رضي الله عنه, he brought his sadaqah. But Umar رضي الله عنه, he said, فجئت بنصف مالي. Umar said, I brought half of my wealth. فقال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and then the messenger said to Umar, ما أبقيت لأهلك, what did you leave for your family? And then Umar رضي الله عنه, he responded by saying, مثله, like it. I gave half, and I've got half left. And this, my beloved brothers and sisters, is how generous they were. But then look at the response that Abu Bakr gave. وَأَتَى أَبُو بَكْرٍ بِكُلِّ مَا عِنْدَهُ. Abu Bakr came with everything he owned and everything that was in his possession. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Then the messenger said to him, to Abu Bakr, مَا أَبْقَيْتَ لَهُمْ, what did you leave for your family? Abu Bakr responded by saying, أَبْقَيْتُ لَهُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, I left for them Allah and His Messenger. Because he brought everything which he owned. He brought everything because he was fulfilling and following the command of the Messenger. And then Umar looked at Abu Bakr and he said to him, لَا أُسَابِقُكَ إِلَى شَيْءٍ أَبَدًا. From today onwards, I am not going to compete with you in anything whatsoever. So I say to my beloved brothers and sisters, this noble month of Ramadan is about to come. Make sure that you benefit from this month in these righteous actions that I'm mentioning. And the last one which I mentioned, which was what? As-sadaqah, giving charity. Giving charity, my beloved brothers and sisters, there are two things that will fall under it. There are two things that will fall under it. The first one is it'am al-ta'am, by giving food. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا فوقاهم الله شر ذلك اليوم ولقاهم نظرة وسرورا وجزاهم بما صبروا جنة وحريرا. Allah tells us in this verse, ويطعمون, they give food. ويطعمون الطعام, they give food out. على حبه مسكينا ويتيما وأسيرا. They give it to the poor, the orphan, the captive. And this is their response. إنما نطعمكم. We are the ones who truly provided for you and gave to you. But why? لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ, for the sake of Allah. لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ, we do not want from you in response, جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We don't want you to reward us and we don't want you to show us gratitude. إِنَّمَا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا. إِنَّا we verily. نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا, we fear Allah, our Lord. يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا. So their issue is fear. They're scared, they're worried of what a day where its punishment and its dealings are very hard, my beloved brothers and sisters. They're giving, they don't want gratitude. A lot of us, when we give, we want to be appreciated in response. We want to be recognized. We want to see the fruits. If we give somebody, we somehow believe that we have an upper hand over that person. We have the rights to dictate what we want for them. We kind of believe that when we give somebody something, there has to be a form of adherence to us. And that wasn't the reason. That wasn't them, the noble, righteous people. Their issue is what? إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا. Allah then says, فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَقَاهُمْ نَظَرَةً وَسُرُورًا. Because they were scared of that day and that punishment, and its fear was high in their hearts. Allah says, فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ, Allah protected them and saved them. شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ, the evils and the hardship and the torment of that day. All of that was in response to their righteous actions. Now, my beloved brothers and sisters, the pious predecessors, كان سلف الصالح يحرصون على إطعام الطعام, they used to strive. The pious predecessors, they used to strive. And what they used to strive to is to feed and to give And they believed that this was one of the righteous actions that they need to come with. وَلِذَٰلِكَ the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, based on the hadith of Abdullah ibn Salam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abdullah ibn Salam, he said, قَدْ قَدِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to the city of Medina. In جَفَلَ النَّاسُ, the people, they ran and they rushed to meet him alayhi salatu wa sallam. And the people, when they ran to him, and they said, قَدِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَدِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَدْ قَدِمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The people, they said, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has come. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم has come. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم has come. They said this three times. Abdullah ibn Salam, who was not a believer at that time, he said, فَجِئْتُ فِي النَّاسِ لِأَنْظُرَ. Abdullah ibn Salam, he said, I came with the people to see him. لِأَنْظُرَ, so I can see him. فَلَمَّا تَبَيَّنْتُ وَجْهَهُ عَرَفْتُ أَنَّ وَجْهَهُ لَيْسَ بِوَجْهِ كَذَّابٍ. And then he said, and when I saw his face clearly, I knew that his face was not the face of a liar. فَكَانَ أَوَّلُ شَيْءٍ سَمِعْتُهُ تَكَلَّمَ بِهِ أَنْ قَالَ. And he said, the first thing I heard him saying was him saying, عليه الصلاة والسلام, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَفْشُوا السَّلَامَ وَأَطْعِمُوا الطَّعَامَ وَصِلُوا الْأَرْحَامَ وَصَلُّوا بِالْلَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامٌ تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ بِسَلَامٍ. O people, spread the greeting of Assalamu alaykum. Feed others, uphold the ties of kinship, and pray during the night when people are sleeping, and you will enter paradise with peace. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clearly instructs, what does he say here? He says, وَأَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامَ, feed others. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, to feed others. Sahabatu Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and salafu hadhi al-ummah, they were ones who would do that. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, it was said about him, and Dawood al-Ta'i and Malik ibn Dinarin and Ahmad ibn Hanbal and others, all of them, لا يفطر, they would not break their fasts, إلا مع اليتامى, except with the orphans, والمساكين, and those who are poor. So my beloved brothers and sisters, we should remember to provide for those who are in need, and to give and feed. And by doing that, my beloved brothers and sisters, it will increase the love between the believers. And that's why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, by doing that, we will enter Jannah through it. The Prophet said, لَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ حَتَّى تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَن تُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى تَحَابُوا. You will not enter Jannah until you believe, and you will not truly believe until you love one another. So loving one another, my beloved brothers and sisters, what brings that? It is إِطْعَامُ الطَّعَامِ, giving people food, providing for them. وَلِذَلِكَ أَبُو سَوَّارِ الْعَدَوِيُّ, he said, كَانَ رَجُلٌ مِنْ بَنِي عَدِيٍ يُصَلُّونَ فِي هَذَا الْمَسْجِدِ. He said, some people of the people of Adi, they would pray in this masjid. مَا أَفْطَرَ أَحَدٌ مِّنْهُمْ, not one of them would break their fasts by themselves. If they could find somebody to eat with them, they would eat. And if not, they would leave their houses and they would come to the masjid and they would bring what they had to the masjid and they would eat with the people in the masjid. So my beloved brothers and sisters, we should nurture ourselves and cultivate ourselves upon these noble, great characteristics. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make us those who are like that. Also, what falls under the sadaqah, the second thing that falls under it, is breaking the fast of those who are fasting. By that, when the time of iftar enters, that we provide them with something to break their fasts with. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ فَطَرَ صَائِمًا كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِهِ غَيْرَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَنْقُصُ مِنْ أَجْرِ الصَّائِمِ شَيْئًا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, anyone who breaks the fasting of the person who is fasting, He breaks his fast at the time when the fasting is being broken. He gives him something to eat. You receive the reward of that person who was fasting, but the reward that he came with will not be reduced. أخرجه أحمد والنسائي وصححه الألباني. Also Salman al-Farisi, he said that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, من فطر فيه صائما كان مغفرة لذنوبه وعتق رقبته من النار وكان له مثل أجره من غير أن ينقص من أجره شيئا. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said that the person who breaks the fast of a person who is fasting, he will receive the forgiveness of his sins. And it would be like the reward of freeing the neck of a believer. Sorry, his neck would be freed from the hellfire. وَعِتْقُ رَقَبَتِهِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Sorry. His neck would be freed from the hellfire. And he would receive the reward of the person whose fasting he broke, without the reward of the person who was fasting be reduced. Then Salman al-Farisi then said, Ya Rasulullah, لَيْسَ كُلُّنَا يَجِدُ مَا يُفْطِرُ بِهِ الصَّائِمُ. Not every one of us is able to find something to break the fasting of a person who is fasting. Some of us may not have food to provide for those people. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, يُعْطِ اللَّهُ هَذَا الثَّوَابُ. Allah will give this reward to who? لِمَنْ فَطَرَ صَائِمًا. The person who breaks the fasting of a person who is fasting, even with a sip of a milk or a date, or a drink of water. The fourth thing that the person needs to come with, my beloved brothers and sisters, is الاجتهاد في قراءة القرآن. Strive to reciting the Quran. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention two things Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors, would observe in this noble month of Ramadan when it came to striving to reading the Quran. The first is kathratu qira'ati al-Qur'ani, they would read the Quran excessively. And the second thing is al-buka' inda qira'atihi aw sima'ihi khushu'an wa ikhbatan lillahi tabarak wa ta'ala. And also crying when reading it and when hearing it out of humility and humbleness for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words that you're hearing. My beloved brothers and sisters, kathratu qira'ati al-Qur'ani, reading the Qur'an excessively in the month of Ramadan is how it should be. Because this month is the month of the Qur'an. It is shahrul Qur'an. So it's upon each and every one of us, and it's binding upon each and every one of us, to increase on the amount of recitation in this month over any other month of the year. And that's why the pious predecessors, they would give al-inaya, excessive consideration, to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this month. The noble angel of Allah, Jibreel, He would study the Qur'an. He would recite the Qur'an. فَكَانَ جِبْرِيلُ يُدَارِسُ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي رَمَضَانَ. He would come to the Messenger, not in any other month, but only in the month of Ramadan. Jibreel would come down and he would recite the Qur'an with the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. عثمان بن عفان رضي الله تعالى عنه, he would complete the Qur'an كل يوم مرة, every day once. And some of the pious predecessors, it was said that يختم في قيام رمضان كل ثلاثة ليال. They would finish the Qur'an in their قيام of Ramadan every 3 nights. Every 3 nights, they would finish the Qur'an. Some of them it was said 7. Every 7 days they would finish the Qur'an. Some of them it was said every 10 days. They used to read the Qur'an in the Salah, and they would also read it outside the salah. And Imam al-Shafi'i, it was narrated and it was transmitted that he would finish the Quran 60 times. He would finish it 60 times in the month of Ramadan. And this was not including his prayer. Qatada, it was said that he would complete it fi kulli sab', every seven consistently. Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, it was said, إِذَا دَخَلَ رَمَضَانِ, if Ramadan entered, تَرَكَ جَمِيعَ الْعِبَادَةِ, he would leave off every other acts of obedience. And when we mean by every other act of obedience is, he would leave off teaching hadith and classes which he had. وَأَقْبَلَ عَلَىٰ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ, and he would only focus on reciting the Qur'an. Now some of you may say, okay, how do we reconcile between this and the Prophet ﷺ statement where he says that the person who reads and completes the Qur'an in less than three days, has not truly understood the Qur'an? Or how do you reconcile the Prophet ﷺ preventing the noble companion Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As? How do you reconcile between that and the acts of these noble companions that you're talking about who are finishing the Qur'an, some of them, in less than 3 days? Al-Imam ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, in his great book, Lata'if al-Ma'arif, he explains it. And he explains it as follows. He says that this prohibition of reciting the Qur'an in less than 3 days is when the person does it consistently. And when it becomes a norms, you're doing it in every single month of the year, you're doing it every single day, that's when the prohibition is taking place. As for times of the year where it's virtuous, such as Ramadan for instance, which is a month which is unique, distinct, it's only one month in the year, nothing like it, then the person is now given an exception for him to benefit from righteous deeds. So he's allowed to read the Qur'an excessively, even if it means that he has to finish it in less than 3 days. Also, if a person goes to a virtuous place where he's not always there, for example, Mecca. I'm not a person who lives in Mecca. For example, I live in London, and I go to Mecca in Ramadan, for instance. So I go there for Umrah once or twice a year. Because it's not somewhere I'm always at, and this place is a virtuous place, I'm also given an exception. So those times, Ibn Rajab, he says, فَيُسْتَحَبُّ الْإِكْثَارُ فِيهَا, you are now permitted to read the Qur'an a lot. The reason is because اِغْتِنَامًا لِفَضِيلَةِ الزَّمَانِ وَالْمَكَانِ, because you're benefiting from the virtue that is connected to the time and the virtue that is connected to the place. And he says, وَهُوَ قَوْلُ أَحْمَدُ وَإِسْحَاقُ, this is the opinion held by Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. This is also the view that was held by Ishaq ibn Rahuya. And not only them two, rather a'imma, many scholars have held that opinion. And of course, this is the view that you can see there are a lot of companions who hold this view, because that's why they were doing it. So now I've spoken about the issue of one reciting the Qur'an, كَثْرَةُ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ, to read a lot of recitation, a lot of the Qur'an. The second part, my beloved brothers and sisters, is الْبُكَاء عِنْدَ تِلَاوَةِ الْقُرْآنِ, is to cry when reciting the Qur'an. Because my beloved brothers and sisters, when you recite the Qur'an, if you cry, it shows and it indicates that you are truly pondering and that you're truly being affected by these words, and that it's not just words that are rolling off your tongue, but that it is something that your tongue and your heart are connected, and that's what's needed, because there always has to be that connection between the tongue and the heart. ولذلك the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he had critiqued and criticized the deviated group, the Khawarij, they were criticized because There was no relationship between the tongue and the heart when it came to the Quran. That's why the Prophet said, يَقْرَأُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. They recite the Quran. لَا يُجَاوِزُ حَنَاجِرَهُمْ. But it doesn't pass their throats. It doesn't pass their collarbones. So it means that the Quran is only exclusive to their tongue. And it's only exclusive to their mouth. So there's nothing, there's no connection between the heart and the tongue. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the greatest example in this matter. As is Bukhari narrated, عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه, that عبد الله بن مسعود, he said that the Prophet came up to him one day and he said to him, اقرأ علي, read on me. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was amazed and he was gobsmacked. He said, أَقْرَأُ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَيْكَ أُنزِلْ. Am I going to read the Qur'an on you when actually the Qur'an has come down on you? Then the Messenger said, إِنِّي أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَسْمَعَهُ مِنْ غَيْرِي. I actually love to hear it from other than myself. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, I recited, فَقَرَأْتُ سُورَةُ النِّسَاءِ. I recited Suratul Nisa. حتى إذا بلغت, until I reached the statement of Allah, فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا. He said, I reached this verse which says, and it means, فكيف, how are you going to be, إذا جئنا if we come, من كل أمة, from every nation, a witness, وجئنا بك, and we bring you forward Muhammad, على هؤلاء شهيدا, a witness over your nation. So how are you going to be that day when your ummah are going to witness against you and you're going to witness against your people? And of course the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he already has conveyed and he has done his responsibility alayhi salatu wasalam. But even then, he told the noble companion, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, hasbuka, stop there. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, faltafattu, I looked at him, فَإِذَا عَيْنَهُ تَضْرِفَانِ. His eyes were watering. His eyes, they were watering. And Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, when the verse came down, أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. When this verse came down, أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ. Are you fascinated with these verses? وَتَضْحَكُونَ, and you laugh, وَلَا تَبْكُونَ, and you don't cry. Abu Hurairah said, فَبَكَى أَهْلُ الصُّفَةِ. The companions who used to live in the masjid, أَهْلُ الصُّفَةِ, who were poor, Abu Hurairah said they cried. حَتَّى جَرَتْ دُمُوعُهُمْ عَلَى خُدُودِهِمْ, until the tears were rolling down their cheeks. Then when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard their crying. And the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam, he heard them crying. He also cried with them, baka ma'ahum. The Prophet cried with them, alayhi salatu wasalam. And Abu Hurairah said, fabakayna bibukaihi. And then our crying increased because the Prophet was crying as well. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam said to them, la yaliju an-nara man baka min khashyatillah. That the hellfire will not touch the person who cries in fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah ibn Umar, it was narrated that he recited Surah Al-Mutaffifin until he reached the verse, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The day when the people are going to stand in front of their Lord. فَبَكَى, he cried, Abdullah ibn Umar, حَتَّى خَرَّ, until he fainted. And he refused to recite anything after it because he was unable to do that. Muzahim ibn Zufar, he said, Salla bina Sufyan al-Thawri al-Maghrib. Sufyan al-Thawri, he led us to Salat al-Maghrib. Faqara'a hatta balagha, he recited until he reached, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. You alone, O Allah, we worship, and only you, O Allah, we seek aid and help from. Baka, he cried, Sufyan al-Thawri, حَتَّى انْقَطَتْ قِرَاءَتُهُ, until his recitation disconnected. ثُمَّ عَادَ فَقَرَأَ الْحَمْدِ. And then he went back to recite from the beginning because he couldn't move forward. He couldn't carry on reading. عند إبراهيم بن الأشعث he said سمعت فضيلا يقول I heard فضيل بن عياض one day say ذات ليلة وهو يقرأ سورة محمد and he was reciting سورة محمد وهو يبكي ويردد هذه الآية and he was crying and he was repeating this verse وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ حَتَّى نَعْلَمَ الْمُجَاهِدِينَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَنَبْلُوَ أَخْبَارَكُمْ Where Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, we should certainly test you until we know those of you who truly strive and remain steadfast. And we'll, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala saying, and we will ascertain about you. So Fudayl rahimahullahu ta'ala, he says, وَنَبْلُوَ أَخْبَارَكُمْ And we will ascertain about you. And he kept repeating this. And he kept saying, Oh Allah, if you ascertain about us, we will become exposed. And he kept repeating this. وَيَبْكِي And he was crying. Number five. The fifth righteous deed that a person needs to come with in this virtuous, noble month of Ramadan is al-julusu fil masjid, sit in the masjid. Hatta طلوع الشمس until the sun rises. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was one who would pray Salatul Fajr and he would remain in his place. جلس في مصلاه, he would sit in his place of prayer حتى تطلع الشمس until the sun rises. أخرجه مسلم and Imam Muslim narrated this. And there's another narration which Tirmidhi narrated on the authority of Anas رضي الله تعالى عنه which that the Prophet said من صلى الفجر anybody who prays فجر في جماعة in a congregation ثم قعد يذكر الله and then he sits and he remains in his seat remembering Allah سبحانه وتعالى حتى تطلع الشمس until the sun rises ثم صلى ركعتين and then he praised two units of ركعات كانت له it is like كأجر حجة it's like you've done a حج وعمرة تام a complete حج a complete عمرة complete the Prophet said it three times Albani authenticated this and there are other scholars who weakened it so there's that discussion going on amongst the scholars whether it's authentic or not. I'm of the view that it's not authentic. But what suffices us is the statement or the authentic hadith which is in Sahih Muslim that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam he would pray Salatul Fajr and he would remain in his seat hatta tatlu' ash-shams until the sun rises. That is authentic. As for this extra two rak'ah that the person prays, there are some scholars who have weakened it, like Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and others. That now reward is not specific to Ramadan, but it's every single time within the year. But again, as I said, everything should be multiplied and efforts should be more in this noble month of Ramadan. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the ability and the strength to gain all of these righteous deeds in the month of Ramadan. The sixth thing that a person needs to come with, my beloved brothers and sisters, is al-i'tikaf. Al-i'tikaf, which is to remain in the masjid. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his Sahih, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعتكف في كل رمضان every Ramadan that came, the Prophet ﷺ would do i'tikaf. He secluded himself in the masjid 10 days. And these were the last 10 days of Ramadan. لكن فلما كان العام الذي قبض فيه But when it was the year which he died and the year which he was passing away, اعتكف 20 يوما. He made it 20 nights. He made it 20 days where he صلى الله عليه وسلم he did i'tikaf. So i'tikaf, my beloved brothers and sisters, is a ibadah التي تجمع كثيرا من الطاعات من التلاوة والصلاة والذكر والدعاء وغيرها. I'tikaf is an ibadah that actually combines between many acts of obedience. such as reciting the Quran, many excessive prayers which you could come with, dhikr, the remembrance of Allah, dua, and other things. So this is when Ramadan comes. The seventh thing that the person should try to do in Ramadan, which is an act of obedience, is Al-Umrah fi Ramadan. Try to do Umrah in Ramadan. It was transmitted authentically from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim. Umrah fi Ramadan ta'dilu hajjah. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a Umrah in Ramadan is equal to a Hajj. And another riwayah says, Hajjatun ma'i. A Hajj with me. So I say, my beloved brothers and sisters, I say to anyone who is being blessed to do that, فَهَنِيئًا لَكَ يَا أَخِي بِحَجَّةٍ مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ. Glad tidings. Is it for the person who received this big virtuous deed of being able to go to Umrah in Ramadan? Number 8. تَحَرِّي لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ. Striving hard to get hold of Laylatul Qadr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. Allah says to us, I have sent down the Quran, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ أي القرآن. I have sent down the Quran in this night of Al-Qadr. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ, Allah says, what do you know about لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ? لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ, خَيْرٌ is better. خَيْرٌ is better. The word خَيْرٌ is of the سِغَةُ الْمُبَالَغَةِ على وزن أفعل. وَسُقِطَ الْأَلِفُ, and the alif was dropped. لِكَثْرَةِ الْإِسْتِعْمَالِ, because it's excessively used, the word خَيْر, so they dropped the alif. خَيْر actually means the best. Okay? The best, it's a superlative. خَيْرٌ is the best. مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ than 1,000 months. So 1,000 months is equal to approximately estimated to be 83 to 84 months. Some of us may not live for 83 to 84 months. We may not get that life. Okay? Sorry, years, sorry. 83 to 84 years. It's 83 to 84 years. Some of us may not get that opportunity. We may not get that chance. Okay? We might die at a very younger age. By just getting hold of one Laylatul Qadr is greater. خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ, greater than 1,000 months of righteous prayer and righteous deeds. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith which is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, مَنْ قَامَ لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ, anyone who stands in the night of Laylatul Qadr, إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا. We're going to come to what it means, إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا, at the ending of our lecture. غُفِرَ لَهُ, you will be forgiven, مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ, your past sins will be forgiven for you. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would make sure that he got hold of Laylatul Qadr. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يتحرى ليلة القدر ويأمر أصحابه بتحريها وكان يوقظ أهله ليالي العشر رجاء يدرك ليلة القدر. The Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he would strive very hard and he would put a lot of effort in making sure that he gets hold of Laylatul Qadr and that he benefits from that noble night. And he would command his companions to strive. And the Messenger would wake up his family and he would tell them, sleeping is not for now. Make sure that we benefit from these last 10 nights. And it's narrated in Musnad Imam Ahmad, in Hadith Ubadah ibn Samit marfu'an, and also Imam al-Nasa'i narrated something similar to it, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من قامها ابتغاءها من قام سوري ابتغاءها ثم وقعت له غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. Anyone who stands up trying to get hold of this month, and it happens that he gets hold of it, he will be forgiven for his past sins and his upcoming sins. So now it's not only the past, but it's also the upcoming sins that you're going to do. Al-Imam Hafiz rahimahullah said, Isnadu ala shart al-sahih. His conditions are of the conditions of Bukhari and Muslim. It was also transmitted from some of the pious predecessors and sahabas and tabi'een, al-ightisal, that they would clean themselves. وَالتَّطَيُّبْ فِي لَيَالِ الْعَشَرْ تَحَرِّيَ لِلَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. They would beautify themselves, they would clean themselves, they would, all of that was preparation for this night, to get hold of it. The ninth thing that the person should come with, my beloved brothers and sisters, is الْإِكْثَارُ مِنَ الذِّكْرِ وَالدُّعَاءِ وَالْإِسْتِغْفَارِ. And it is to increase in the remembrance of Allah, and also to increase in supplication, and also to increase in asking for forgiveness. Ikhwati al-fudala, my noble brothers and sisters, the days and the nights of Ramadan are azminatun fadilah. They are virtuous times. Faghtanimha. Wallahi, benefit from it, my brothers and sisters. Bil-ikhtari min al-dhikri wa-du'ai. In increasing in the remembrance of Allah and supplication, especially in the times when the supplication is accepted. And it is, one, عند الإفطار, the time when you're breaking your fast for the one who is fasting. This time your dua is not rejected. Number two, ثلث الليل الأخير, the last third of the night when Allah تبارك وتعالى descends. And Allah says, وَهَلْ مِنْ سَائِلٍ, is there anyone asking? Is there any one of you who's requesting? فَأُعْطِيَهُ, and I give him. هَلْ مِنْ مُسْتَغْفِرٍ, is there anyone asking for forgiveness? فَأَغْفِرَ لَهُ, and I can ask, and I can forgive him. And I can forgive him. The third one, my beloved brothers and sisters, is الْإِسْتِغْفَارُ بِالْأَسْحَارِ, asking Allah forgiveness at night. And in the morning, قَالَ تَعَالَى وَبِالْأَسْتَحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. They are the ones who ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness in the night and the morning. So after all of those 9 points that I mentioned, my beloved brothers and sisters, I want to remind you, and I want to remind myself as well, that all of that which I have told you, and all of those righteous deeds which I have mentioned, we need to do it with what? It all has to be done with sincerity. Na'am ikhwati al-fudala. Yes, my beloved brothers and sisters, al-ikhlas, or sincerity. How many people? فَكَمْ مِنْ صَائِمٍ, how many people are fasting? لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعَ وَالْعَطَشِ, he has not received anything from his fasting except thirst and hunger. وَكَمْ مِنْ قَائِمٍ, how many people who were standing up and they were praying? لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ قِيَامِهِ إِلَّا السَّهْرَ وَالْتَعْبِ, all he has received from his standing and the tiredness, and his standing was tiredness and energy which he gave out, but no reward. أَعَادَنَ اللَّهُ وَإِيَّاكَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ, I ask Allah for him to protect us from that, each and every one of us. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized on the two. So your hunger and your thirst of Ramadan doesn't go to waste, and your tiredness that you endure from the praying doesn't go to waste. Both of the times we did the Messenger say, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. So you're fasting. If it's not done with إيمان and احتساب, it's just going to be mere thirst and hunger. If your قيام is not done with إيمان واحتسابا, it just becomes a mere standing which you just endure from it, tiredness and etc. And that's why Salafu Hadihi al-Ummah, the pious predecessors, the noble generation, they were the ones who made sure that they did it with sincerity. Ikhlas. Sincerity. They hid it. فَهَذَا التَّابِعِيُّ الْجَلِيلُ. Look at this noble tabi'i, Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani. He's talking about his teacher, Hamad ibn Zaydin. Sorry, Hamad ibn Zaydin is talking about his teacher, Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani. Hamad ibn Zayd is going to speak to us and tell us about his teacher, Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani. Hamad ibn Zayd, who is a student, is going to talk about his teacher, Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani. And he said, "Kana Ayyub," that Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani was one, "Rubbama hadatha bil hadith," he would narrate a narration. And then he would feel like he wants to cry. Fayariq, his heart becomes soft, and tears are about to gush from him. Fayaltafitu, he looks at the people. Then he holds himself back. ويقول him, he then responds by saying, ما أشد الزكام. How large and how much is the flu? He shows himself as though a person has got a flu. لِإِخْفَاءِ الْبُكَاءِ, so he can conceal his crying. Muhammad ibn Wasi', and he said, لَقَدْ أَدْرَكْتُ رِجَالًا, I met a number of men and a number of noble individuals. كَانَ الرَّجُلُ يَكُونُ رَأْسُ مَعَ رَأْسِ مْرَأَتِي, a man would be sleeping with his wife. His head and her head would be on one pillow. على وسادة وقد بل ما تحت خده وقد بل ما تحت خده من دموعه, his cheek would be filled with tears. لا تشعر به امرأته, his wife is unaware of this. ولقد أدركت رجالا, I met a group of people. يقوم أحدهم في الصف, that one of them would stand up in the prayer, in the line with the masjid, the jama'ah. فَتَسِيلُ دُمُوعُهُ, his tears would pour from his eyes. وَلَا يَشْعُرُ بِهِ الَّذِي بِجَنْبِهِ, the one who's right next to him will not know that he's crying. Ibn Abi Adiyun, he said, Dawood ibn Abi Hind, he fasts for 40 years. لا يعلم به أهله, his family were not aware of it. He would take the food that his wife gives him and he would leave it with the poor people. He would take all the food which she gave him and he would take it to the poor and he would leave it with them. And when the time of iftar came, he would go and he would eat whatever they left for him. For 40 years he was fasting and his wife wasn't aware of it. So my beloved brothers and sisters, all of those which you are doing, if you're not doing it with sincerity, then nothing of it will be accepted. And the second thing is, if you're not doing it in accordance to the Prophet's method and the way he did it, then nothing of it will be accepted. Many of us, my beloved brothers and sisters, when this month enters, we're very heedless. We spend our time sleeping. We waste our time. And we turn away from the mercy of Allah that we could receive. We don't benefit from these openings and these opportunities Allah has given us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's because we don't benefit from these opportunities and we're very heedless of it, and that we turn away from, is because of those reasons why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has made us live a very hard life, and that we're suffering because of it. As Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي مَنْ أَسْرَفَ وَلَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ وَلَعَذَابُ الْآخِرَةِ أشد وأبقى. Anyone who turns away from the remembrance of Allah, for verily that person has a very hard life, and Allah says, we will resurrect them the day of judgment blind. Why blind? Allah says to him, when he says, رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا, oh Allah, why have you resurrected me? Why have you gathered me here blind? وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا, and I was one who used to see. Allah says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا, our verses came to you. Verses, you were told about verses of Ramadan and the virtues that were in it. فَنَسِيتَهَا, and then you forgot it. You turned away from it. The word nisyan, originally in the language, it means at-tark. You left it. وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى, and today you will be left. Because Allah doesn't forget. It means Allah will leave you in the hellfire. وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي مَنْ أَسْرَفَ, Allah says, like that, we reward the one who exceeds. وَلَمْ يُؤْمِنَ, and he doesn't believe in the verses of your Lord. وَلَعَذَابُ الْآخِرَةِ أَشَدُّ وَأَبْقَى, and the punishment of Allah, the Day of Judgment, is greater and long-lasting. So if you really think that what you're going through in this world is actually hard, then know that what's waiting for you on the other side is even worse and is even longer-lasting. So my beloved brothers and sisters, don't turn away. Don't turn away from this noble month. Don't be heedless of it. Allah is wanting and He wants to forgive you. Allah wants to give you Jannah. And this is one of the opportunities that you get. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us reach this noble month of Ramadan, and He also gives us the ability to benefit from each and every second of it. Allah is the one who has the ability to do that for us. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليه.